Welcome to PartialArc.com. Don't do that.
Do you want to hear a story? I'm not letting go.
Are you ready for this?
Follow your heart.
I'm going in!
This is...
Blockbuster Smash-Up!
Welcome to another episode of Blockbuster Smash-Up. I'm your host, Jay Jones, and as each episode, I'll be joined by my co-host, Todd G. Levin, and our special guests as we try to smash one globally accepted good film and one globally accepted bad film into one hopefully cohesive new film for you guys. With that said, let's dive in and meet our guests. So Todd, please introduce our guests.
Well, to my right, on the radio.
Very important to totally know where people are based on location.
Just so you guys get the, you know, the geography of the room here. On my right is the lovely Anne-Marie Davidson.
Hi.
Writer, playwright, all around awesome.
Stenographer.
Thank
person.
Actually, oh my God. Yes, true.
Wait, do you actually do steno stuff?
And yeah.
Do you I'm have a the psychic.
Special, do you have the special...
No, apparently we have a weird connection.
Yeah, it's very strange.
Do you have the special keyboard?
No, I have a special pedal. It's like attached to my laptop and I press it and I hear things.
What?
Sorry, that was
Are
really
you
obtuse.
Sure you're...
you press a pedal and then
you
hear things.
Do
you
do this by
things.
Yourself? Or
no, I get recordings from hearings.
Yeah.
And I press the pedal to play and then I have a fast forward and a rewind and I use my foot
so you can quickly scroll back and through the
yes.
audios.
How
that
did you...
Cool.
That's so weird. Why did you
it
say
really
she just finished?
Pulled that out of the
that's
air.
That's so strange.
I don't know.
I guess I just look like... It's a new pick up one like, girl, you look like you are a stenographer. what's your sign?
Hey, girl.
You're a stenographer.
What's your favorite shortcut?
You look you could type faster than 85 WPM, girl.
And on our left here is my friend Casey Leventhal.
Hello there.
From Being Casey. From Casey's
from
Life.
Canada.
From that classic 90s TV show, Being Casey.
From Canada, but the place of Canada that doesn't snow.
Oh, yeah, that's right. We figured this out earlier.
What's that?
That there's a place in Canada that it doesn't snow.
It doesn't
and they
snow.
Didn't teach and, us that in America.
And they're not like boring holes in the ice and then going ice fishing every weekend.
Yeah, I mean, don't be ashamed, listeners. You know there were some of you that definitely thought every part of Canada snowed.
This is also an educational program.
Yeah, this is what we try to strive for.
I'll make sure that my Canadian accent comes out somewhere during the recording. Now that I'm like three beers in.
Because
like,
nobody's believing you at this point. Will. They're like, I haven't heard.
Oh, yeah. It'll be good.
There we go.
It'll be real
this,
good.
Should we talk about these movies, eh?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Anyway, from Canada.
So anyway, I'm KZ.
That's the story.
Were you from Canada? I just want to clarify.
Just to be certain.
Okay.
Well, those are our guests. And now for the get to know you game.
Perfect.
Thanks.
Perfectly clean transition.
What's your, in terms of cinematically, what's your biggest guilty pleasure?
I watched a lot of like BBC period pieces based on classic literature.
Okay.
I do that quite a lot.
Okay. Like, what is a favorite? A top
the
pick?
The Ang Lee version of Sense and Sensibility that Emma Thompson wrote every time. I could watch that movie like six times a week and like still be like
would that
totally into it.
Be a guilty pleasure?
Yeah, because I do like science fiction and comedy and like real things and like women in fucking...
Science fiction, comedy, real
all,
things.
All things.
Very, you know, disparate things
space
things
aliens so normal CNN fair
so
guys.
Sense and
but
Sensibility
also,
is like a guilty pleasure
I'm
for you
also like
okay
a
that's
pretty
so great
massive feminist and
so like someone would be like you're such a poser for
yeah I'm
basically
such a poser for
like this is such like a thing you would
yeah
somebody
women
would
in like ridiculous clothing going to balls and like pining after men who are like inappropriately matched for them based on their fortunes
but
it's
they,
like ridiculous
but listen they look
I swear I was trying to watch Star Wars and then this
yeah.
Sense and Sensibility came on
I don't know
what to do I fell asleep take a nap and when I woke up
I thought it was Pride and Prejudice and Zombies I swear and then it just ended up being
just
normal
Pride and Prejudice
yeah
unfortunately
that's really funny have you seen that Pride and Prejudice the BBC one
yes I've seen them
right?
all like I've seen them all
Isn't
I don't even know which one you're talking about
no I'm talking about the famous
with
one
Colin
with
Firth.
Colin Firth like the most famous
yes.
version of that story I
and
think
and that was how I realized I was a heterosexual woman
wow
I'm pretty sure
Pride and Prejudice that was the day
probably why I watch these movies.
The
Mr.
credits.
Darcy, I am down with that.
That's why I like guys
Holy
who are kind of mean to me.
Colin Firth,
sure.
Colin Firth.
Colin Firth was responsible for my sexual awakening.
Whoa.
So thank you, Colin.
That's actually a great... Oh, man. That's a good question. I'm gonna put that one down for next time.
What? Was Colin Firth responsible for your sexual awakening?
What was... If movie-wise, what was responsible for your sexual awakening? For me,
David
it was...
David Duchovny in The X-Files for me.
Yeah, for me,
Colin
it was...
David Duchovny in The X-Files?
Jane Fonda in Barbarella.
Should we just do this question right now?
example for my sexual awakening.
We have retconned this. Okay, so now it is instead what movie was responsible for your sexual awakening?
I have a great one.
What is yours, Casey?
So when I was, so my parents are really into like artsy films, and the first R-rated movie they ever took me to was a movie called Lone Star with Sam Shepard. I don't even remember what it was, but I just remember it was full of sex, and I was like 7 years old, and I was just like, what the hell is all
of
this?
Your brain was like,
and then after that,
yes.
So was it Sam Shepard who was responsible for your sexual awakening?
In many ways.
Okay. I mean,
sure. Hats off to you, Shan. Sam Shepard, wherever you are.
Coincidentally, that's the same year my parents introduced me to alcohol.
What? So. Wait, what? Hold on. Just kidding.
Is this intervention?
What's happening?
Casey, we brought you here to talk about Lone Star and to talk about your alcoholic addiction.
Okay. And that your parents may have introduced you to things far too early.
Parents, wow. come out now.
Hi, guys.
Told you never to talk about this.
I actually have a Sean Connery sexual awakening thing James Bond. I apparently was sexually awake, but I remember like very distinctly seeing James Bond in bed after he'd like, you know, had gone to town on some lady.
You know.
Whoa. And he was like kind of naked and I saw his thigh and I was like, I think I get sex. Yeah. I'm thinking that it's like maybe an 8-year-old.
I want something about that. Like,
I didn't want it. I just I thought I understood it finally.
I get you it. Know? Thighs. I get why we have them now.
So Sean Connery's thighs were also responsible. So Colin Firth, David Duchovny, and Sean Connery.
We're gonna get more into that in a few minutes.
Right after these messages.
Now let's dive into the smash-up.
Smash up.
All right, so we're going to play Blockbuster Smash Up. This is the game where Todd and I have secretly selected a globally accepted good film and a globally accepted bad film. We don't know what the other one has picked as in regards to a film. And Todd, what do you have this
episode? I've got the bad film.
And I have the globally accepted good film.
I was going to say this year.
This year. All right, and on the count of three, we're going to say these films at the same time and forever smash them canonically, and we will have to create a new film from these two films colliding with one another. So Todd, are you ready?
Yes, I am.
God, you
sorry. And hold on, Todd has bad film.
Yeah,
Jay has good.
I have the good film. All right, one, two, three. Ghostbusters.
Ed.
Oh, jeez. Okay, so you have to explain to people what Ed is.
Okay, Ed is the 1996 Matt LeBlanc comedy where.
Is this the one with the monkey?
With the monkey.
Oh my god.
Where
you can go fuck yourself.
Matt
right now.
LeBlanc, this is like the worst movie. Matt LeBlanc plays a guy who is a baseball player on a farm team. He's actually really good, but he has performance anxiety.
On a farm team?
A minor league team. And,
gotcha,
you know,
gotcha.
And
gotcha.
His coach thinks he can make pros.
I don't know these baseball terms, Todd. Farm team?
Sports, monkey, sports,
gotcha.
Matt LeBlanc.
Gotcha.
He's a great pitcher, but when big crowds are around, he can't really perform as well. The owner has some interesting ideas.
I understand what he's going through, by the way.
Thank you, Casey. Lone Star over here.
Exactly.
The coach has some interesting ideas as to how to make the team better, and one of those things is hiring a monkey, a chimpanzee, to be exact.
Who is this coach? He's just like, guys.
Exactly.
Just listen through it.
The coach, do we remember?
I forgot his name. He's a famous actor. But
John Leguizamo?
No, he's that guy.
It's like Brian Dennehy or something.
No, but it's...
Someone who looks exactly like Brian Dennehy.
It's one of those like famous old guys. I hate saying Brian it this Dennehy. Way, but it's true. It's one of those famous
one
old guys.
One of those famous old guys.
I mean, it's true. Once you see him, you'll be like, oh yeah, he's like the famous old guy.
I've been 90 for 50 years.
The thing is, like, this monkey can play baseball and is really good at playing baseball.
Was
Why?
This part of the plan?
This was the plan, is hiring
How
a monkey to play.
How specific of a monkey? Like, this coach found not only a monkey that he could put around people, but a monkey that could also play baseball.
Well, this chimpanzee was not just any chimpanzee. This chimp was Mickey Mantle's chimpanzee. And before Mickey Mantle died, he taught him all he knew about baseball. Oh,
what the fuck?
So,
are you serious?
So he's on the team, and it's like everyone's like, oh, but Matt LeBlanc and Ed is the name of the
The chimp
is named Ed. Matt LeBlanc's name is Deuce Cooper.
Jesus.
Deuce Cooper, Matt LeBlanc's character, and Ed the chimp become roommates. And,
of course they do.
And best
and
friends.
And zany antics ensue.
How did he sign that lease? Did he co-sign the lease, the monkey?
I don't know. The weirdest part about the whole movie is that the chimp is not a chimp. It's a guy in a suit. Yeah.
What?
No, yeah.
So was this post-Friends or pre-Friends?
This is mid-Friends.
Mid-Friends. So Matt LeBlanc is like coming on the set in his baseball outfit, and a guy is just in a chimpanzee suit, and he's like, I fucking
making
made it.
Millions per episode, by the way.
This is a great idea.
This is a good one.
This is what I need to be doing right
somebody
now.
Somebody had to pitch this to like a room full of executives.
Not only that, but then when it was done, it had to go up the chain of approval.
Every studio person was like, yes.
What eventually happens is that Ed gets so good and so well known that the owner wants to trade him. And instead of trading him to like a different team, he somehow trades him to like this guy, this evil guy who,
God damn it.
Instead of wanting to...
Is it Chris Kattan? Because I'm just imagining the evil guy is Chris Kattan.
I don't know.
Right?
Probably.
I don't know why.
Basically, the guy wants to like put him in a cage and make him wear like a clown suit or whatever, even though they've already seen that this miraculous monkey can like play baseball and everything.
So this guy's like, I can make millions off of a baseball playing monkey, but I want to put him in a clown suit.
This is correct.
Because I'm evil?
This
People
is correct.
Are into all kinds of weird
Matt
stuff.
LeBlanc comes and saves him. There's this really weird scene where
please
like,
tell me there's a high-speed chase of some sort.
Yes, there is.
Oh, thank God.
Meanwhile, the big game is coming up, right? The big game that's going to like, you know, potentially get Matt LeBlanc into the majors. Deuce Cooper, Matt LeBlanc, is up on the mound. He's a pitcher, by the way. And he doesn't...
I can't do this without my monkey.
And then guess who shows up right at the end?
Oh my God. This is like Angels in the Outfield.
It's
like, there are monkeys.
It's literally like one of the worst ideas that's ever existed.
Instead of flapping their wings, do they all pull out bananas and they're just like, I believe in the monkey.
Please, so, God, if there is a God, let him win just once. I have that in my whole monologue. Like, in my
and
head
and
still,
honestly, that's really just the end. So there is the 1996 epic Matt LeBlanc film, Ed.
That's amazing.
This is why I've been
all
laughing
right,
the
mixing
best
that with...
Yeah, we're mixing that with Ghostbusters. So, jeez. For anyone that hasn't seen the 1984 classic film Ghostbusters, which I actually think is probably my favorite film of all time, the actual one sentence pitch of this movie, fun fact, that Dan Aykroyd has, was ghost janitors in New York. That was the one sentence pitch
of that
film.
Dan Aykroyd is the fucking best. When it comes to, so his first movie was Blues Brothers. He turned in a 480 page script for that movie. He didn't know like what screenwriting was. And
just wait. I'm going to give you the synopsis of Ghostbusters for anyone who hasn't ever seen Ghostbusters or heard about it, but I'll tell you about what the original draft of Ghostbusters was like.
Excellent.
So Ghostbusters is about a movie about three broke scientists. Their grants run out, so they decide to start busting ghosts in a city in New York City, and they start to get good at it. It's strangely good because there's more and more ghosts appearing, and because of this, with one of their clients, they find out that there's like an evil Sumerian god that's coming back to Earth to try to take over Earth or kill everybody, whatever. The plan's kind of vague, but it doesn't matter. It's bad.
It's evil.
And the Ghostbusters must team up with a new member and the mayor, and they must fight and defeat the evil Sumerian god Gozer, and it results in a great giant Stay Puff marshmallow attacking New York City.
One
at
of
the
most
end.
Bizarre.
And it's amazing. Also, the original script for Ghostbusters was so insanely crazy. The original plot was that there were multiple ghostbusting groups. It was Dan Aykroyd, John Belushi, and Eddie Murphy.
Oh my God.
There were like three or four different ghostbusting groups. Within the first 20 minutes, the Stay Puft Marshmallow scene happened.
Oh no.
And throughout the movie, they're crossing time and multiple dimensions. The original film in 1984 was budgeted at $300 million.
Whoa.
That was the original script of Ghostbusters.
This is Dan Aykroyd's business, I'm sure.
Can one of you become an eccentric billionaire, find
and
that
make that movie,
and make that movie that before everybody dies
across time and dimensions?
That is a goal of mine. I might sell out just so that I can make that.
Just make that movie, please.
That make the original
awesome.
Ghostbusters
Somebody.
Movie.
So that is the plot of Ghostbusters, and now we must smash Ghostbusters and Ed, a movie about a chimpanzee who is the former baseball monkey of, what was it?
The Mickey Mantle.
Of Mickey Mantle.
Yeah.
Okay. Would anybody like to take a crack at the cold open of this film?
Okay, so we open with Rasputin.
All right, no matter what you say, I'm in, no matter what you say
you
now.
You can basically say Rasputin about anything.
We open on Rasputin.
Who who is, of course, you know, like in touch with the other world.
Yes.
And somebody's trying to assassinate him. So we open on the scene where people are coming to shoot him, and he has a chimp with him. And he's teaching the chimp the last instructions on how to communicate with the other world.
Excellent.
And then the czar's men come in, shoot him in the face.
I picture like the chimp is hiding, right? You know, he's hiding behind like all of Rasputin's like science stuff and bottles and potions, all those kind of stuff and potions. You know. And like as they come in, he like, you know, they shoot him, and like there's like a silhouette of like Rasputin like falling and dying, and you see like the chimp's eyes, and he's just like, you know, he's like freaking out, and then and then, you know, and then it like goes to black vividly, or whatever, right?
Yeah. Vividly.
Okay, we cut to a baseball team. We cut to a baseball team.
Cut to present day.
That are struggling. Baseball team is struggling. One of them, the Dan Aykroyd character, they're having a really tough time. They're trying to amp up the crowd and try new things. Like, I invented this like weird way to hit the baseball, like a special baseball bat. Like, and he's always into like weird gadgets and stuff. And they're like, we could use this. It could like hit the ball a lot farther, but it like goes wrong and it like destroys like the dugout or something. And like, you guys are too crazy for sports. And like, they throw him out of the sports, and only like one like minor league will like pick up these three guys, these like random crazy baseball players. And they're like, well, what are we gonna do? We gotta spice it up. Like, we need like a mascot. And they're like, well, I saw this like down in this like weird like shop. Like, I heard about this chimp. And they're like, oh, well,
this is the same shop that the Mogwai from Gremlins came from. It's just this one shop in New York.
That has all the weird animals. And it's this chimpanzee. And they're like, well, let's bring him in. Let's see if he
can play baseball somehow.
Is he a chimpanzee that's alive, or is he the ghost of the former chimpanzee?
Is he a non-corporeal spirit? Oh, like he's the mascot is just a stuffed dead chimpanzee?
No, because if they can commune with the dead, like, I think he's the dead version.
Who can commune with the dead?
The Ghostbusters guys.
the guys that play baseball?
Yeah, I think they can.
Wait, the Ghostbusters can't?
They don't know that they can see ghosts at this moment, but they discover they
Okay, Venkman can see ghosts, but he does not give any fucks. He never tells anybody about it.
Yeah, right.
I was thinking maybe the reason that the baseball team is not doing very well is because as the dude is pitching, he's always seeing all these ghosts everywhere.
He's always distracted.
Oh, there you go.
So who are our players? So Venkman is our pitcher, and he can see ghosts, but he doesn't tell anybody. Harold Ramis is like our right fielder, but he's just making like gadgets out there. So he's really talented as a baseball player, but he can't care less. Like, he's out there.
He's like a good hitter.
He's a really good hitter.
He just hits home runs.
They're already on a minor league team. It's just a struggling minor league team.
And
they bring in like new players, like maybe Winston's
a new player.
He's fucking great, but
he's
like
the guy who's going to fix it all. They're like, we bring this guy in, he's going to crush it. He's going to do really well.
But then like, you know, what, the coach has a crazy idea to get a mascot, and he goes to
the coach Matt LeBlanc.
I think the coach is Rick Moranis.
Because Rick Moranis
just like can't get it together. We tried everything. The monkeys will make it happen.
Well, I was calculating the trajectory of the balls, and I realized that.
Well, that's not really Lewis. Lewis just doesn't know anything. That's Harold Ramis.
Well, okay. You'll come over later, and
and we'll talk about mascots. So they bring the monkey to the game,
and this is the dead stuffed mascot monkey.
And this is like the reverse of Angels in the Outfield. Now the ghosts, thanks to the monkey's presence, are like helping them win games. Like, they're actually doing really well.
They're starting to draw a crowd.
To everyone else, this is just a dead stuffed monkey.
So the monkey is a stuffed dead monkey.
But he's Rasputin's dead monkey.
Okay.
And so all the ghosts are now like,
so the team
know,
is called
out.
The Rasputins now. They renamed themselves. They've called themselves the Rasputins.
What if it's the Tsars versus the Bolsheviks?
Where is this taking place? Is this
in America? This is a minor league team, man.
This is in the heart of America.
They have weird names for minor league teams.
Ghosts can like move from Russia.
No, I'm just referencing the two teams in the heart of America are named the Bolsheviks, and what's the other team?
Progressive.
Would it be the Bolsheviks and
the Romanovs?
The Romanovs. Yeah.
So they're the Romanovs. That's their team name. They're the Romanovs, right?
Okay. So they're the Romanovs, and their main rival, like the evil Iceland team from Mighty Ducks, is
the Bolsheviks. The Cincinnati Bolsheviks.
And the Bolsheviks are a major league team.
They're really good.
And the Bolsheviks.
No, they're, There's minor.
It's like the final championship round. Like the one best minor league team each year gets to fight and play like the big major league team. It's like kind of like, hey, like hey, right. we'll throw you something. Like you get to play the major league
no,
team.
No, but what happens if they beat the major league team?
Yeah. They get to be league? In the major league. Because that's how sports works.
That is actually how it works. That's kind of how it works in England with the soccer.
Oh, wow.
Crazy.
So if they beat the Bolsheviks, which by the way, the Bolsheviks were part of like ratting them out of being like these kind of like random dudes. So like from the beginning, these guys have been their enemies. And the dude, the guy who has no dick, is the guy is the captain of the Bolsheviks.
Yeah, there'd be like a scuffle. Right. There needs to be like an early on scuffle between these two teams.
Oh, yeah.
They, like, yeah, they come get into in a their fight. Turf. Yeah, right.
Hey,
right.
man. Like those like well, total 90s, like, you're a wuss.
Yeah.
So what?
They basically just replay the scene from The Sandlot, but with adults.
Yeah. And yeah. Sigourney Weaver's there and she's dating the guy from the other team.
Yes. She's dating the man with no dick. She's dating the man with no dick.
Yeah. And basically, in that first scuffle, he goes in, like, unbeknownst to, like, one of his, like, cronies or, like, one of his goons goes in and, like, messes with Egon's, like, baseball bat and, like messes with, like, the settings or something. Yeah. And that's what, like,
that's what ruins the.
It, like, knocks a guy out or, like, it doesn't kill a guy.
And it hits the already broken Jumbotron and causes it to fall on a bunch of fans.
He's like, that wasn't how it's supposed to work. And, like, see, these guys are crazy. We got to shut them down.
Yeah, right. And for some reason, like, the game, even though they're shut down, the game is still sort of like scheduled, right?
Yeah.
So they can still they're still eligible to play this like final game against the Bolsheviks. So they have to they got to go back to their hometown where there's like the baseball diamond like, that they all grew up in.
It's like all dilapidated.
This is really a sequel to The Sandlot, like later in life.
Yeah,
you know,
I think so.
When they all realized they had ghost powers.
Yeah. So it's only Venkman.
It's only Venkman, it's only Aykroyd, it's only
Egon. So Venkman's Bill Murray.
Yeah.
Unless we want to make him Matt LeBlanc.
You know what? LeBlanc is going to be Rasputin. Matt LeBlanc plays Rasputin.
Perfect.
So we go back to their home court.
Yeah.
And they start getting a team together and they're like, we're going to beat the Bolsheviks. That's what it is again.
Yeah, that's right. And that's why that's where they get Winston. And he's like, I can help, you know.
He's like, I can help. You know, I'm just a regular guy. Like, just give me a bat and I'll crush it.
And then maybe Venkman's like, I have a secret to tell you guys. There have been ghosts at every single one of
and
our
fucking
games.
Because of this monkey, there's been a lot more ghosts and they've been helping us.
Like in Angels in Outfield kind of type, the ghosts start helping them play the game.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
You know what I mean?
They start doing ghost shenanigans. Yeah. What's like a good ghost shenanigans?
You know, like the ball is just like moving around in the air all willy-nilly and
the ghost of like, I don't know, Nostradamus is there.
Yeah, who are all our ghosts?
This is where I feel is the good part to bring in Matt LeBlanc as Rasputin, because Rasputin can be the leader among the ghosts at the baseball field.
Well, historically speaking, and then we also have
Yeah, Rasputin historically was a huge baseball fan.
And then we also have like Nostradamus.
We're missing a very important piece.
Okay.
And that is, where does this monkey come in? Because right now it's still a dead stuffed monkey, okay? And yes.
Oh, I thought it was just going to be like a totem.
Egon's special bat thing that was broken or whatever.
Yeah.
I think accidentally gets pointed at the dead stuffed monkey.
Yeah.
And then it like animates, it somehow reanimates.
Oh, and it starts to move.
Yeah. And it's like, because it's an accelerator on pack or whatever.
Yeah.
And it movie stuff.
Yeah, movie sci-fi terms. You got it.
And it reanimates this stuffed dead monkey, you know, and they don't know what to call him. He speaks Russian, and they just call him Ed. You know, he is. They just call him Ed, but
he just speaks Russian, so the monkey is not only able to manipulate the spiritual world, but also speaks.
No, but Rasputin can translate, because I'm pretty sure Rasputin speaks like all languages.
Oh, yeah.
Of course
RC
he does.
And Mandarin, and
I mean, this movie is really rewriting Rasputin's, like, he was a pretty cool dude.
Yeah.
He was really a Renaissance man of his time.
He speaks like all the languages from Game of Thrones, just because he invented all
I know Dothraki, let me tell you how to speak the Dothraki.
So, but this is Matt LeBlanc speaking to
So, but what does the monkey start doing?
So
I think what I was going to say is they have to have a practice game among the local like townspeople. And then like Sigourney Weaver has to like come around and like she starts seeing him in a whole new light because he's like playing baseball.
Because he's crushing it.
Yeah. She's like, baseball, you're so good at that.
Wow, they're really good at supernatural baseball.
Yeah.
I kind of like that more than dickless baseball.
Well, that's the thing. Like, I don't think she knows that it's ghosts. Like, I don't think anyone can see that it's ghosts.
So we see it from her eyes and it's just just people playing baseball. Yeah, they we just see look it like they're from crushing everybody it. Else's eyes, and it's like you see.
Maybe Ed, the Russian Rasputin monkey, puts a spell on the other guys so that they can see all of the ghosts helping.
Oh, that they can help as well.
Yeah, right, yeah.
I feel like they should all be able to see the ghosts.
Yeah, they should all be able to see the ghosts.
And the thing is, like, I think right now we're going to start to kind of form, like, our ghost, like, almost like a Space Jam. Like, we're forming, like, our human and our ghost, like, super team. Yes. So we've got, like,
yeah.
we can have, like, classic historical figures like Lincoln and, like, other people, like, hanging out.
Who
and
would
just,
be
like,
great at baseball? Like, Ben Franklin.
Oh, yeah. Like, oh, just people,
real good
like,
at baseball.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Benjamin Franklin, the best baseball player. A dinosaur ghost is there. Yeah. Like,
yeah.
Like, Rasputin is pulling the best baseball players throughout time to play.
Genghis Khan. I feel like Tyrannosaurus Rex would be terrible at baseball.
He's really good at bunting, you know,
because
he just holds the bat right there.
The guy's got potential. He's a good bunter.
So,
which
like,
is wonderful.
They're playing more and more games, and they're starting to, like, they're building a lot of, like, fame. And now the Bolsheviks are starting to get a little bit worried because they hear that this team is starting, they might actually become a problem. And, like, now Sigourney Weaver is kind of like, I don't know who I like more, like the man with no dick or Venkman.
I feel like they're hanging out a lot by like a dock. Am I wrong? Like,
yeah,
they
sure.
Yeah,
oh,
totally.
By a dock.
Oh yeah,
like
they're going
lake.
On a date by a dock.
And the ghosts are all there, like telling him what to say, but she doesn't know.
Oh my god,
and he's really bad.
And he's really bad, and like doesn't know what to do. And they're like, no, man. And like some like famous romantic poet is like whispering in his
Shakespeare
ear.
Shakespeare is there.
Shakespeare is there.
Bill, you gotta help me. It's which is fun because it's Bill Murray.
Like all the Russian poets of old are just there.
Yeah, they're all like, oh yeah, it's Bill Murray with a bunch of other poets being like, what do we say? I don't know. What do you
like
think? What
does Dostoevsky, Tolstoy?
Yeah. Yeah, they're all there.
And then they have sex and like Sigmund Freud is there. Kinsey's like giving him pointers. Famous porn stars from the old
times. That's amazing. So the man with no dick is starting to get suspicious because his lady, his girlfriend, has disappeared.
Spending a lot of time
with
Venkman.
And followed her and realized she's going to a lot of these games.
She's
and that's
going to the Romanovs games.
And sees that the Romanovs are getting really good. So like he kind of traces their steps and like maybe he takes like Dan Aykroyd's character out for drinks. Like we can be friends. Like we're good competitors. And like he reveals that he got this monkey from the shop.
Right.
He goes to the shop. And he finds like the Necronomicon.
Oh.
So he gets his own spiritual weapon.
Excellent.
Mm-hmm. So now we lead into like
Dickless has the Necronomicon.
Now like these evil the evil baseball players, like evil ghost spirit baseball players are like attacking their baseball players and like affecting their games. Like he shows up at their games and like reads the book and now the ghosts are like making it bad for
them.
So
it's like Ed Gein and you know like Ted Bundy and all these like evil just like
meanwhile Ras
Bundy would have been a great baseball.
Meanwhile, Rasputin, a hero in this movie. But
of course.
So they're like, we don't trust you, Rasputin. We don't need you guys. Like, we'll do like what we did before. And like,
who doesn't trust Rasputin?
The team. They're like the ghosts aren't helping them anymore. They're almost like they don't know why.
Oh,
but the ghosts aren't
because Dickless.
Because Dickless is messing with the ghosts. He's sending his evil ghosts to mess with their ghosts. But they can't. They don't know what's happening.
They can't see.
They can't see them.
Sure,
And they're just like, you know, we can't trust you guys anymore. But like, and they have like a breakup. And it's like Sigourney Weaver and the chimpanzee. Like Sigourney Weaver's like protective of Ed. And like he tried to help you and it's like we don't need him and like we don't need you and like Venkman and
you're Sigourney not who Weaver. I thought you were Venkman. I thought you were a good guy and then she like runs away
and like you know you see like Bill Shakespeare just being like no not the right way sorry man
not like this. There has to be a scene after this where Sigourney Weaver and Ed the recently reanimated Russian monkey at a bar somewhere.
The best sentence anyone's ever said.
They're at like a bar somewhere and they're kind of just sitting there like sulking over like what happened, you know. They're looking at the TV and they see the man with no dick is on TV and in his back pocket they're like,
you see the book?
Yeah, there's like, you know, like the Necronomicon.
And the monkey's like pointing.
And it's like, "Oh my god, that is the Book of the Dead."
So we have to have the final showdown. It's going to be against what's the two teams?
The Romanovs.
It's the Romanovs
and the Bolsheviks.
And the Bolsheviks have their final game and like he's super confident cuz he's like they don't have their ghosts anymore, like they're done, like we're gonna win.
Right.
And like they start the game and they're obviously losing.
They're not doing well, but then like maybe the monkey realizes that the Necronomicon is in the pocket.
You know
and
what?
And he steals the monkey and it's up to Sigourney Weaver to get the Necronomicon.
To free the monkey and get the Necronomicon.
Because
what happens is the monkey disappears. So Ed gets the Necronomicon, but he also steals the monkey.
Yeah.
And then they think like the monkey abandoned them. They're like, Ed was our friend and he just left us and we lost all these games and like nobody's around anymore. And like so Sigourney Weaver's like, he would never just leave you, like, and they're just like, ah, screw Ed, and then she's the only one that's, like, on the case.
Right. Could there be a moment where, like, the ghosts aren't there, but they play, and they think the ghosts are there? She's like, oh, yeah, they're all here for you, and they can't see him anymore.
Yeah.
And they play, but then they play great, because they, like, think.
Oh,
but
it was there
in
you them, go, yeah.
You know what? In them all along,
I
they
like
can
it.
Do it.
I think that's the end. I think that's how they do it. Like, okay. While they're still trying to get the ghosts back, they're still, like, locked up with the Necronomicon or Ed or whatever, but she's still like, they're here, and then they think they're playing better.
Yeah, doing the angel wings.
And doing the angel wings.
In the end, the ghosts are like, you know, they're there. They're like, you didn't need our help.
Yeah.
You didn't need us all along.
Yeah.
So wait.
This is a very impassioned speech given by Rasputin, played by Matt LeBlanc.
Yes, Matt LeBlanc gives the best motivational sports speech. Like, you thought Denzel Washington, you thought Bill Pullman in Independence Day, like the best rallying speech. It's in fact Matt LeBlanc with a thick Russian accent.
As a ghost version.
Can he
version
have like his
Rasputin
robe, but like a baseball uniform over it?
Yes.
Oh yes.
My God.
Yes.
Absolutely.
And the proper facial hair.
And the proper like scraggly hair and crazy.
All the beard.
Oh yeah.
And oh yeah.
Bullet holes and.
Right. And like
everything.
Tons of rings.
Yeah.
Yeah. And, oh, and a spell
this
book.
Is,
perhaps
guys,
a staff.
This is the best thing.
ever happened to anyone. I feel incredibly honored
to have created this movie.
What's this like ending moment? So that's the end with the speech, but then like the denouement, so to speak, of this movie is.
All right, I got
is
it.
Is there a baseball
so
mascot?
He, that's he does some
a huge
kind.
Thing?
He does some kind of like summoning thing on himself and like possesses himself with like something terrifying.
Yeah.
And like the last, like it's the last out, and the Bolsheviks are down one run, and the Romanovs are up one run, and all Venkman has to do is strike out the last player. But instead of the regular player, that is. Instead, it's Dickless that pushes the guy out of the way and steps up to the plate. But Venkman stares him down, and he can see spirits. And he sees that this Dickless is possessed with some, like, terrifying, evil, dark spirit.
Right.
Mano y mano with this evil, dark Dickless. And Venkman just has to strike him out.
Well, but what is the evil, dark Dickless? What kind of...
He pulls all the evil baseball spirits into himself.
Into, like, a giant...
He's just like... He is like, I am Legion.
And he's, like a giant 50-foot-tall, like, bloated, evil spirit. That's just like as tall as the
God, and I don't know what's happening right now, but I know it's not illegal, so we're gonna let it still play out. He still has to pitch against this giant 50-foot-tall man. So he's there, this giant 50-foot-tall possessed evil demon,
and he's
version
terrified
of Dickless.
Because this whole time what we didn't know is that he has performance anxiety.
He has performance anxiety.
And that's what's troubling
and
him.
And that's why the ghost
Sigourney
kind
Weaver's
of helped him.
Clearly.
The ghost kind of helped alleviate that, and he was like, finally they were like, we believe in you. You can do this.
Yeah.
And
so,
Venkman strikes him out.
So he strikes him out. Dickless, I think, explodes.
Sure.
Yeah.
Because
yeah,
the ghosts, he can't contain them. They
too many. I think there should be a moment where Venkman and Sigourney Weaver, like, kiss or something like that. And then they're, like, about to go have sex. And he, like, looks at the unanimated dead Russian monkey.
So he's now a dead taxidermy
like,
monkey.
He gives him a little these, wink. Like, he reanimates for a wink.
Right.
Like a little sparkle in his eye.
Exactly.
Perfect.
It's like in the dugout or in like the locker room, you know.
That's right.
It's like that's where they have him up on the wall, you know. And
what it is
he's
it's
a mascot.
Him,
now,
the last
you
shot
know?
Of the film is them going into the room, and then it's just a close pan in on the monkey, and you think he's still frozen, and it's just a tight shot of his face with a ding! Wink, ding, and then cut to black. Oh my God! What
Wonderful.
The? What is this movie called?
Base Busters.
Ghost like, baseballers.
Ghost baseballers. Ghost ballers.
Ghost ballers.
Ghost ballers.
Ghost ballers. For sure.
I think
sure.
Ghost ballers is definitely the
I
name.
I feel like it's just like a layered meaning.
There's a lot of ghost balling happening.
Ghost ballers.
Yeah.
Okay, so Ghost Ballers, what is the poster for Ghost Ballers?
Okay,
no, you guys, it's a sky, it's a blue sky with, like, in the clouds is Rasputin.
Yes.
But he's, like, giving a thumbs up.
Right.
Yes.
And then it's, like, Peter Venkman and Sigourney Weaver with a baseball. Everybody else is there.
I think you got, like, a V formation. The Romanovs and the Bolsheviks, right? All the characters
of
our team.
Yeah, you've got the team's facing off against
but
each other.
Both ghosts and humans
are lined up.
And in like, in the middle is Venkman and Sigourney Weaver
and Ed. Ed is there.
Yeah. Ed is holding
dead.
Both of their hands.
But dead.
Yeah.
he's a dead rotting monkey.
Yeah. Or like Venkman is holding the corpse of
them. It's like if you thought that ghosts couldn't play baseball, you're dead wrong.
You're dead wrong.
That's it.
That's the tagline for the movie.
Oh God.
exactly it. That's Ghost exactly
ballers.
It.
And you know what's the best part about Ghost Ballers? It's going to play really well in Russia.
It's going to play real well. Right,
right. That's a big market.
That's an emerging market.
That's
right
an emerging
now.
Market.
You know, we got a lot of films geared towards China. We got to crack that Russian.
Yeah.
You know, we're going to make it
this
happen.
This is the one. This is the one.
This is the one to make it happen.
Captures the Russian market.
You heard us, Studios. You heard us, Bill Murray. Ghost Ballers.
Ghost Ballers.
The key to those billions.
It's not even trademark or copywritten or anything. It's like, please, somebody make this.
You heard us,
make it happen. All right, guys. So that was our smash up, and that'll be taking us into our game. Marry, fuck, kill.
Marry, fuck, marry, fuck, kill. Marry, fuck, marry, fuck, kill. Marry, fuck, marry, fuck, kill.
All right, this is our game, marry, fuck, kill. This is where we decide whether we marry, fuck, or kill specific films. Todd, what are our films today?
Well, since this was a very cartoony kind of episode, I'm going to go with cartoon live action hybrids. That's the theme, the very specific theme for this.
I love that. Right?
So we're going to do Space Jam.
Excellent.
Who Framed Roger Rabbit?
Oh my god.
And Casper.
Oh, you know what? Oh my god. This actually creates more of a conundrum than I
marry,
thought it
fuck,
would.
Kill.
Does anyone have theirs? Todd, what do you got?
I'm going to marry Space Jam.
Yeah.
Because that movie's just one of my all-time favorite movies.
Oh, absolutely.
It's so crazy, weird, wonderful. And Michael Jordan. And Bill Murray. And Danny DeVito. And like, it's just great. And by the way, Babs Bunny is like... very attractive. I'm just gonna go ahead and
there
say
was a
it.
Lot of confused boys at that age. There was I don't know what's going on.
I think a lot of kids perhaps learned that they were, what's the word for someone who's sexually attracted to,
they
like,
were sexually awakened to Space
animal
Jam?
Animal, you know, like animal furries. Like there's a
that's not from like watching sports teams and their mascot. No,
like the, you know, because they see this anthropomorphized bunny and they're just like, something's happening inside. Mm-hmm. I think I'd marry Space Jam. I'd fuck Who Framed Roger Rabbit because that movie
very
is
sexy,
just crazy, weird, and sexy. It'd be a really fun.
I mean, it's like a noir
cartoon night, you know, very fun and all that kind of stuff. But
let's
you wouldn't want to
forget Jessica Rabbit,
and let's not forget Jessica Rabbit. And then I'd kill Casper because sorry, Casper.
Poor Casper.
I am going to follow up because I am going to disagree and say that I would. A Mary Casper, because I like the occult and all of that nonsense.
And I'm sure you were one of those girls that was
Bill
watching.
And Bill Pullman, and he's got a Lazarus machine.
No, it was the Devon Sawa thing.
It wasn't as much a Devon Sawa.
For our
Devon Sawa
generation.
Could get it, for sure.
Yeah.
For sure. Totally fuck Who Framed Roger Rabbit, because of all of the things listed.
Yeah.
It's a very sexy movie.
It's a very sexy movie. And then you'd have
and
to kill
Space Jam. I'm sorry.
That's okay.
It's so sad.
It's a little sad. I feel like a part of me has died, but like
one of them has to go.
One of them has to
go. Yeah, you gotta kill one of them. So
I follow that up
point.
With I would also kill Space Jam just to keep Michael Jordan from doing Hanes commercials. So that would be just
that
cap him off
made
right
so
there.
So much money off of those Hanes
just
commercials.
To keep, just to keep on Michael on. Jordan from entering
just
MLB.
Just right there, yeah. Just keep him from the baseball. Just like, oh, he died so young. Some random person just killed him mid Space Jam movie. We'll never know what he did afterwards. I would definitely kill Space Jam. And you know what? I would also marry Casper for a different reason, because strangely, when we were talking about in personal questions like sexual awakenings, it wasn't sexual, but when I saw Christina Ricci as a kid in that movie, I was like, there's something going on. I'm getting like butterflies, I'm getting feelings. Like I was like, I get the thing with the sex and the
counter question, Babs Bunny or Christina Ricci?
Okay. My young self would have still said, I mean, there was something magical about Christina Ricci.
I gotta say Christina Ricci, and you know why? Wednesday Addams.
Oh yeah.
Oh my god, Wednesday Addams. Yeah, you're right.
Because
that was
like,
she was kind of for a young me, for probably young you as well. She was bad in a thousand for like there's something going
because
on.
Because it was Addams Family Values, then Casper. And it was just like, this chick?
Was she not also in Edward Scissorhands?
No.
No, that was you're thinking of Winona Ryder.
Yeah,
but that was close. I mean, I think for Casper,
she was batting 1,000 3 years in a row.
Christina Ricci. With,
and in that kind of spooky gothic realm, you know?
And I was into that.
You know,
same thing, too.
Alternative girls. Yeah.
It's like it's a spooky house, but like, it's a fun spooky house. Mm-hmm. Like, it's not, you know, you're not going into the basement and finding like, oh, a bunch of people were murdered here and like tons of dead bodies. It's like, we're kind of fun and we're ghosts and there's a cool, crazy machine in here. I'd be like, this is awesome.
Yeah.
And then, absolutely, I'm going to fuck Who Framed Roger Rabbit.
I mean, most fuckable movie of the night,
most
guys.
Fuckable movie.
Besides our Rasputin movie.
Yeah, besides Ghost Balls.
I mean, Matt LeBlanc as Rasputin is very fuckable. But besides getting off of that Rasputin beard, I mean, the Who Framed Roger Rabbit is very sexy.
Great.
That car is very sexy.
Yeah,
so Who Framed Roger Rabbit and yes, kill Space Jam to prevent underwear commercials. Casey?
I would also have to kill Space Jam.
Oh, man.
It's okay. Guys, I'm marrying it, so it's like alive.
We all looked to Todd. It's alive. Well, it's okay,
we just wanted to make sure you're fine.
I do have a confession, though. I have never seen Space Jam.
Whoa.
Wow.
Who were your parents? Were they horrible?
They
were
took
they
away
monsters?
My childhood with fucking Lone Star.
You're like, I'm never watching anything childlike ever again.
No,
never. It's only HBO from here on out.
I did not have Nickelodeon. I didn't have, like, the best I got, this I'm very grateful for, but I got the Batman animated series.
Whoa, that's great.
In Canada. Excellent. But I would actually fuck Casper.
Ooh, I fuck Casper. Yeah.
Because I feel like Christina Ricci would be something that I would say, like, it was interesting, but I wouldn't want to do it again. But, like,
my one night with Wednesday Addams, and that was it.
And that's good. And then Who Framed Roger Rabbit, I would marry that to have, like, the experience of consummating that marriage and then depriving anybody else from
of ever
the,
of being ever with Who Framed Roger Rabbit.
Yeah.
So we would all have wow. to be at the wedding and be like, I also I slept with Who Framed Roger Rabbit.
Yeah, he's just committing like, yeah, to it.
He's committing.
I'm here with my, like, weird Casper marriage. Yeah.
Your three witnesses to the marriage have also fucked Roger Rabbit.
Yeah.
Yes, but I,
you would have to know that by the end of the night, we'd all be killing your
oh, no.
you know, partner.
No, you guys would want to kill, but I have married, so...
Oh, I guess.
Yeah,
you'd prevent
so,
us.
So Space
you'd
Jam
have to stop
still
us from
exists.
Space Jam lives. Yeah. Space Jam.
I'd have to... Actually, I guess I'd have to fend you off and potentially kill all of you.
Yeah, I guess. Yeah. It'd be quite a wedding, really. I mean, very exciting to go to the Who Framed Roger Rabbit wedding.
I want
to
say now, just talking about Casper, there's some pretty misogynistic overtones in that movie.
Is there? Really?
I only remember the magic.
Now that I talk about it, I remember one of the main key things that Casper would say to Christina Ricci is, can I keep you?
Oh, he did say, I want to keep
that?
You.
Can I keep you?
That's true.
And that was one
wait,
of the...
Wait, but that's...
That's creepy.
Okay, yes,
that's,
however...
That's, she's not an object
she's,
to be kept.
But she's not the subject of the movie. It's his, from his perspective, and it's his house... And his older brothers
and
or whatever.
And she should
assholes.
Be in the kitchen.
Yes.
And he should own her and put her in any room that he, of his choosing. No, but like.
He's turning into a totally different movie, which I would watch. I would watch it.
It was like Black Snake Moan.
Especially if it was British and Colin Firth was Casper.
Oh, yeah. Right,
we'd have a real
then
good.
I would, yeah.
Then nope. All is forgiven.
Yeah. All right, guys. So that was Mary Fuck Kill. And that was our smash up. Thanks for joining us.
Yay.
Thanks for listening. And I hope you learned a lot about Rasputin and chimpanzees. And if you're enjoying the show and you've got a second or two, a quick rating or review on iTunes would be amazing. Or share the show with a friend. Either way, we really appreciate your support. And as always, we'll be posting a new episode every other week. And if you'd like to download more episodes or check out other similar podcasts, head over to partialarc.com. That's ARC with a C. Of course, you can email us any questions or fun movie ideas, whether good movies or bad movies, at blockbustersmashup@gmail.com, or follow us on Twitter and Instagram at partialarc. If you'd like to hear more from Anna Marie Davidson, follow her on Twitter at writerannamarie. And if you want to follow up with Casey Leventhal, check him out on Instagram at caseyiscool. And be sure to follow Todd on Twitter and Instagram at tglevin. Thanks for listening, and see you on the next episode of Blockbuster Smashup.
Let's go home.